I love it when a plan comes together. About 10 minutes ago, Richard Wood walked in, and of course, he was over in Commerce this morning at another breakfast, and he's supposed to be a downturn.
We didn't have a time to flip a coin on some things beforehand, but we're going to do it in a certain order. You have your names there. There you go. Good morning. Again, we want to welcome everybody here to hear the two remaining candidates for the Georgia State School Board Superintendent. I'm Joe Dendy, and I'm chairman of the Cobb County Republican Party, and we're happy to host this event. It is our desire that this debate will help educate the voters of Cobb and Georgia with the principles upon which you'll govern and mold the minds of our children and grandchildren. We've made arrangements with Michael and Melissa Honeykey from Bartow County to videotape this. Plus, we have other videotapes going here, and we have media in the room. We want to welcome all of you here and hope that y'all will help us get the word out. And the videotapes, the primary purpose of that is to be able to have it on the cobbgop.org, also on georgiapolitics.org, and other blogs. We will eventually, what we'll do initially is have a 1 hour clip on there, and then we're going to be breaking it down by the question. So if any of you, if any of the news media want to use a specific question, it will be broken down that way for you. Let's try to get the word out to as many people as possible. I felt the importance of this race. That's why we went ahead and canceled everything else to bring these two people in. And we always had to get the state control and get Richard here from Congress, but I was determined we were going to do this because it's so important. Instructions, we're going to have the questions. I'll be the moderator and ask the questions. Questions have come from a number of different sources. I've actually received over 175 questions from individuals, and so for the last 2 days I've been working through those and up to about 1:30 this morning. Each of you will have 2 minutes to answer the questions. Again, hoping to give you a little bit more leeway on this as far as so we're not giving you a 60-second answer, but you should be able to answer in 2 minutes. Our timekeeper is where? Oh, right here, okay. We have a 30-second yellow card and the stop red card. You may finish your sentence that you're in the middle of when the stop card goes up, but if you go beyond that, you'll hit the bell. And then the floor opens up. It's fair game to address your opponent's record and qualifications. However, any kind of personal attacks are not fair game. In each of you will have 3 minutes. We'll go to opening statements and we can spend more time on the issues. But at the end, each of you will have a closing statement for 3 minutes. And we'll do it alphabetically with Mike being the first and Richard being the last. Okay. So let's get started. Gentlemen, for the record, would you tell us how your name will appear on the ballot, if that's correct, and the name plaque on your podium, and how the audience can find your website. What's your web address?
Okay. Probably my full name would be Richard Leewood, so it'll be the formal name that I have, but I'll be the last person on the ballot, so that'll be easy. As far as my website, you can check it out at woodsforsuper.com. We also have a Facebook page as well, so I invite you to join and stop by.
Thank you for being here today. We appreciate that greatly. I love informed voters. My full name will be Michael, Mike in parentheses, Buck on the ballot. My website is buckforsuperintendent.com. Please go to the website. You can find out all about my character, credentials, my platform, and my stand on those issues.
Mike, you'll answer this first question then. Please describe your educational training and experience that makes you qualified to be Georgia's next state school superintendent.
Oh, I love this question. I am a career educator. 31 years in the field, every level. I was a pre-K director. I have done elementary principalship. I've done high school principalship. Imagine living through 7 years as a high school principal with the last name Buck. Think about what I read about myself on occasion. I've been a central office employee. I was an assistant superintendent on state schools before I moved to the State Department of Education, where I've been chief academic officer for the past 3.5 years. My training. I am a tri-dog. I hope that doesn't offend anybody, but I go dogs. I got my bachelor's degree, my master's degree, and my doctorate from the University of Georgia. I got my educational specialist degree from Augusta State University. It was Augusta College. That's where I began my career. I wanted to be a Division I caliber athlete, but I wasn't. So those are my qualifications for this race, 31 years of experience and the training that spans that time.
Okay, again, initially when I got into education, I got my undergraduate degree from Kennesaw State. Somebody mentioned I think it's Sprayberry. That was actually my first student teaching experience here up in this area. But eventually settled down in Irwin County in the southern part of the state where I worked for 22 years. 14 years in the classroom as a high school social studies teacher, coach of various sports, teacher of the year. Received awards for teaching experience and activities and technology as far as usage in the classroom. 8 years was spent in the area of administration, working as assistant principal, principal, K-5 curriculum director, hospital homeschool, and the hospital homebound and homeschool system director, middle school pre-K principal, middle school, high school principal, or alternative school principal as well, over testing, transportation, host of things. If you suffer from insomnia, please go to my website. You can see the whole thing that's there with that. But it is something that, more importantly, it was 22 years at the school level. So each day I dealt with our parents, I dealt with our kids, I dealt, with the community at large and the teachers and all the things we talked about today. These are things that I have firsthand experience in administering and seeing what the impact was at the local level. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. With a $100 applause, we'll get a lot more questions in. Appreciate that, though.
Well, I like applause.
We'll hold it to the end. Richard, you'll be the first one to answer this question. There seems to be quite a bit of confusion in the specific roles of the state school superintendent, the State Board of Education, the Georgia Legislature, and the governor, and how these entities interact. Would you first tell us what do you think are the primary roles of the state school superintendent? In other words, give us a job description of the office that you're seeking. And second, how you as state school superintendent will interact with the governor's office, the legislature, and the state school board?
As far as the nature of the office itself, again, it's an elected constitutional office. And so that means I have to follow the Constitution of Georgia. One of the things we look at in Article 8 of the Constitution specifically spells it kind of spills out the role of education in Georgia. Again, that is highly localized. And so for me, as an individual, I'm not here to tell local schools how to run their school system, but to help them run the school system. Make sure that you have the supplies, the personnel, everything needed to properly and adequately educate, your children across the board. So that is my commitment, across the state. Now, working with that means I do have to work with an appointed board. The state school board is appointed by the governor. I cannot go in and just arbitrarily start making policy. I cannot go, as your next state school superintendent, make change laws. That requires working together with individuals. Now, as an individual, that, kind of sets up the second part of the question. It is my commitment to work with each and every one, whether it be the governor, the school board, the legislature. And again, I've already started that process. Again, I think it is a process that needs to be done early on, reaching out to these individuals, letting them know that I'm an individual who will work together, because first and foremost is our children. And that is a vested interest that all of us have, and that has to be the focus. So we can work through the weeds and kind of get through some of the policy, but let's make sure that we do focus on what is absolutely necessary to make sure that our kids have the education they do. I'm committed to do that, but also I'm committed as this individual that I represent you. And one of the important things is being your voice up there underneath the Golden Dome to express your wishes and make sure that your voice is being heard to all, because this one office focuses on education, and that is my commitment to you as your next state school superintendent. Thank you.
Thank you. And I will give you my response from the heart, and then I'll give you the technical response for the job description. I view the state school superintendent as the chief champion for our children, their parents, the educators out there, and our communities. Now, the role of the state school superintendent is to make recommendations to the State Board of Education for policy, procedure, guidelines. That is the chief responsibility of the state school superintendent is to bring wisdom, guidance, expertise to the state board so they can implement policy. I want to make sure that we get the best advice to our state board members. We get the resources out to our local districts that they need to do the job best. You will not change educational outcomes from the State Department of Education alone. It is the point of the spear. It's the grassroots. It's the classroom teacher. Those teachers need our support. They need our resources. They need a vision for moving forward. The state school superintendent has to be that champion, has to guide that process, has to be a cheerleader for public education across the state. I have to build bridges with the governor's office, with the legislature, with the State Board of Education. We have to work together. You can't do it as a CEO and not have everybody else at the table. If we don't get the home, the school, and the community working together, we will never be as good as we could be. If we don't get the state school superintendent, the State Board of Education, the governor's office, and the legislature on the same sheet of music, we will not make the progress we need to be. We need to do. I will build those bridges.
Thank you. The next question goes to Mike. Goes to both of you, but Mike will be the first one to answer. It was announced on Thursday that the Department of Education signed a 5-year contract with McGraw-Hill to develop new tests based on Common Core standards. First, in a time where school systems are still having furlough days and haven't seen raises in years, do you think it was a good idea to spend millions of dollars on a new testing system, the Georgia Measures of Academic Progress, or GMAP, in short, with McGraw-Hill? And second part of the question, do you think it's right and fair for the outgoing state school superintendent to overlook the ongoing debate on the acceptance of Common Core in Georgia and commit our state to Common Core assessments for 5 years? Or do you think he should have deferred that decision to the new superintendent who will take office in 6 months? And there's a third part of the question. Why do you think Superintendent Large did this?
I have to go first on that question. First question, we had to move forward with a testing program. I believe my philosophy of testing is less and more, but there are certain guidelines that we have to adhere to. We have got to raise the level of achievement, and we've got to raise the level of accountability across the state, and we have to prove that we've got a return on investment to our taxpayers. We've got to raise the level of rigor in these tests, and these tests have to pass outside external forces looking at the rigor of the test. So we had to move forward with that. The old testing program was outdated. We had to move forward. We've got to have assessments that will closely align with what our students will have to take on the SAT and the ACT as they move forward. We could not really delay that decision. We have to produce these tests. It is a time-consuming process to do it and do it well with input from our stakeholders. Can't just flip a switch and make that happen. So timing was very important. Should Dr. Barch have made the decision at that time frame? The reality of the situation is we had to move forward with this testing protocol in order to have it ready to meet the guidelines that we are faced with. We have to meet federal guidelines, and I know that's a hot topic, but we get $1 billion a year in annual dollars for our most needy children. Our special needs students, we have to provide for them. For our Title I students that are coming from homes where they don't have the support they need, if we don't have a good system in place, we can't turn back $1 billion every year and expect our districts to be able to do what they need to do to help those young people.
Richard, same question.
In regard to the test itself, I thoroughly reject the notion that we had to do this. You know, one of the things we look at is that for us as the state of Georgia, constitutionally speaking, we have the constitutional right to dictate what goes on in our state. Now, for me as an individual, that works with testing and this nature, you know, when I look at what we are doing and the waste that we have seen, you know, this is an absolute waste. We had to first decide what we were actually going to teach our kids. The first thing, soundly, as you look at educational doctrine and data, you make sure that you look at what you are actually going to teach the kids first, you know, and then you begin to construct the test. And so I think we made a gross misstep there because it seemed that it was an act that, you know, definitely tries to do more in locking us into Common Core than continue on the debate. And I'm here to let you know that that debate continues. So I did think that was a very, you know, bad error on the judgment part on the DOE and Dr. Barr's continue that. Because not all money, federal money, is tied to the things that we're talking about there. There are Title I programs that go in there. And so we can work through that. The grant that we looked at, the Race to the Top grant, you know, was independent money. We still, rather, you know, Title I money and things of that nature was not tied to that. So we need to look at that. Also, we need to look at the relationship we have with the federal government. You know, and that's why I suppose we do a complete audit across the state to see what is the funding that we actually are responsible for and to make sure that, you know, we are getting the bang for the buck. We may actually be spending a lot more money across the state than we actually need to from what we're getting from the federal government. So we have to look and do some things that are smart, because this takes us down a path and we're looking at our kids. Remember, you know, one thing we talk about is the test, the test, the test. And I can tell you as an individual, coming out of No Child Left Behind with the CRCT and things of that nature, we need to go back and refocus. It's about the kids, the kids, the kids. And that's where our judgment and that's where our decisions to be need to be made and focused on. And that's my commitment as your next state school superintendent.
Thank you, Richard. First, you're the first one to ask this next one. And quite honestly, of the 175 questions that I got and the research that I did, about 90% of those questions were on Common Core. So we already spent some time on Common Core this morning, along with other things. Next question. This is really a point-blank question. Do you support Common Core standards?
Yes.
And why do you think Common Core standards are so important?
2010, when I was a candidate for the same office, I opposed the Race to the Top grant. And that's where Common Core was embedded, you know, for Georgia. I oppose it still. That is something that I have been very, you know, and I think the only good that I can say that has come out of Common Core and the standards themselves is it has gotten people engaged. And that's what we need. We're having people that are formed. We in education have always said that we want, you know, the community involved. Well, I can tell you across the state, the community is involved on this issue. And so it is out of my commitment to make sure that we have the best. Now, when you look at, you know, from a constitutional standpoint, what we did was incorrect, because Article 1, Section 8 of the Constitution, you know, ensures us that we as a state control education and not the federal government. And first and foremost, we must adhere, and we as Republicans and conservatives must make sure that we stand on the Constitution. If we cannot get that right, we can't get anything right. I'll be honest with that, and that's my deep feeling with that. Academically, as you look at the standards themselves, we know that they are inferior to the Georgia Performance Standards, even though some would say that they are closely reliant, but they have been scored. But even with that, if you say they are closely reliant, the Georgia Performance Standards are ranked sixth in the nation. Now, I'm an old coach, and one thing I looked at is I never saw the teammates go around bragging we're number six, okay? We need to make sure that we're number one. You know, so that's the things we need to look at. We need to make sure that we offer our kids the very best we have. The standards we have and the Common Core standards, I can tell you from an academic standpoint, they do not meet us, you know, where we need to be. We will not be number one, and there's a reason it's called common for, you know, in the terminology, because that's exactly what it is. But I believe us as a state, you know, we are exceptional. And we as an American are definitely exceptional, and we want to be the best. Thank you.
I'm on the record from the outset, from the day that I made the announcement to enter this race, that I strongly support our current standards for a wide variety of reasons that I can articulate. But I have also said, my opinion is not the most important opinion. It is also the opinion of the governor's office, the legislature, the Georgia Chamber of Commerce and its affiliates, the PTA, and our military. All of those entities support the standards. You know the other group that strongly supports them? Those that are closest to the education of our children. 75% or so of our educators want us to stay the course with these standards. We are roughly into the third year of implementation, 2 years with the standards being taught in the classroom, 3 years if you talk about how we had to roll it out. The teachers and the students do not need to have us rip up the standards and start new. The standards themselves are very good. The controversy has become the methodology, the instructional techniques that are used, and the resources, and those are all a local decision where local districts have complete autonomy in making those decisions. You know, the last thing that I will add to that is that they're working. At the end of 2012, and some people laugh when I say this, we had all kind of positive results. SAT results went up. ACT results went up. Advanced placement results, where we're number 9 in the country, by the way, results went up. NAEP reading, NAEP math, NAEP science. While using essentially these standards, they all went in the right direction. One state in the country went up in all those metrics. That state was Georgia, using those standards.
The next question goes to Mike first. And, you know, I gave the candidates rules, and we give the audience rules too. No side comments that we can hear up here, okay? No, that's being very discourteous to the gentlemen that are here. Okay, next question. The Common Core standards were created from evidence-based research. What specific evidence-based research was used to create these standards? And we start with Mike.
Well, on the math side, the National Council of Teachers of Mathematics was at the table with each of these things. The Governors Association drove a lot of the development of the Common Core standards, and they got experts from a wide variety of venues, a wide variety of states, and they benchmarked these standards against what it's looking like internationally. Because as you all know, we haven't been shaking out so well on those international assessments. And part of that is because we haven't expected as much of our young people. So those entities came together, gathered input in each of the states. This is another thing that gets lost in the shuffle. Each of the states had ample opportunity to weigh in, to vet, to shape, to mold what we wound up with at the end of the day with those standards. So all of those experts and the individual states, we posted the standards of that State Board of Education in full record. They were before I got there, but everybody had the opportunity to weigh in, just as they will as we move forward. And I want to say, I got some time left, that I am open to continuously reviewing what we have in place and modifying as we need to make sure we get better.
In regard to the accreditation process of the standards themselves, now you have two individuals that, you know, in fact, as far as the accreditation board itself, you have two individuals, one for math, one for English language arts. Now, these two individuals who had the deepest knowledge as far as the standards, and specifically in their field, did not sign off on these standards. So that lets you know something right off the bat that individuals, and I think Mostofsky up in Massachusetts, you know, who was definitely well known for her work in English language arts, has been vocal about this, that, you know, there are concerns that, you know, I think one of my opponents, Dr. Bacchial, you know, did some, you know, research on the map, again, for Senator Ligon. So we are, you know, looking at these standards we knew were somewhat valid, you know, or not really valid across the board. Now, in regard to being an international benchmark, these standards have not been benchmarked, okay? There's nothing that we have as far as any data research. Initially, you know, the individuals who were behind Common Core came out and said, yes, they're benchmarked. But they pulled back from that statement because they know that it was an incorrect statement itself. So what we're looking at is that, you know, these are, you know, the standards themselves that have not been tested. They have not been proven. We have no idea. A lot of the work, when you look across the board at the past, and especially some of this recent testing, whether it's 2010, 2012, well, our students, they grew up under Georgia performance standards. That reflects close to 13 years of these kids being taught with these standards, especially with the English language arts and math. So I think we need to look at, you know, what we have across the board, you know, as far as what we're actually saying, you know, as benchmark standards and those that are true to the course. And so, you know, we're dealing with an unknown. We absolutely have no idea about these standards and their capability and how much they will actually, quote, help the child. But from what we've seen so far, even with the Brookings Institute, which recently came out with a study, and it showed minimal gain, and especially for states that are tied very directly to Common Core standards. Georgia is one of those states.
Thank you. Okay. Richard, this one you'll start with. The message Georgians are receiving in the media and from the State Department of Education is the importance of increasing workforce training. With regards to Common Core Georgia performance standards, The path does not include algebra until the ninth grade or higher math above algebra 2 by the end of the high school's career, academic career. How can Georgia expect to increase the STEM-ready students, STEM being science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, how can Georgia increase STEM-ready students if higher math expectations are not even included in the standards? Is Georgia only interested in creating a mid-level workforce, and do you think the Common Core standards are continuing to dumb down our children? And we'll start with Richard.
Okay. The standard set, especially in the area of math, you know, that's one of the things that has been kind of higher. If you want to go to Georgia Tech and some of these higher, you know, institutes of learning, you know, you have to have that algebra at eighth grade so that you can continue on with that. So I think we have to have that flexibility as a state to do things that we know are right. Now, the Common Core standards themselves, if you look, I forget the individual's name, but as we look at this, the standards were basically, you know, a blanket to say, okay, everybody would maybe be ready for a two-year college, okay? That put everybody in that same boat. But that, you know, for our higher educational kids, for the STEM learning kids, that's a disservice. You know, so we have to have the flexibility to control that and make sure that at the local level, we can provide that for the kids. Now, as far as the math standards themselves, again, there are weaknesses in that. Again, one of the things we have done across the board within the past few years in Georgia, you know, we have went through math 1, 2, 3, 4. Some of you may remember that, the integrated math that we have. And again, when Dr. Bars came in, we basically said you have a choice, you can either integrate it or either do traditional math, you know, at the local level. Well, there's no consistency there. And so we have to make sure that we are online, because math is something that is very, very important. Because if you do not have a foundation in math, you know, you will not be able to succeed or have the opportunity to succeed across the board. And that means we need to make sure we get it right in the K-5 area. We have to have that foundation down there. Because I guarantee you that once you get to middle school and high school and beyond, those are things we have to look at and make sure they have those skill sets. And one of the telling things that a lot of people don't mention, you look at how many kids are taking remedial math when they go to our technical schools, when they go to our four-year colleges. That's unacceptable. If you graduate from high school in Georgia, you should not be taking remediation in higher learning. Okay, thank you.
Mike? Now, we've got some of the highest graduation requirements in the country, including four maths. And that third math, the third math in that sequence, must be at the advanced algebra, basically advanced algebra, algebra 2, trig, that level for our students to graduate. So by no means is that dumbing it down. Most states have lower graduation requirements than we do in the state of Georgia. As far as when young people can take Algebra 1, that is a local decision. They set up their sequence, their curriculum, the timing for when their young people are ready, prepared for Algebra 1. In some places, I know that's occurring at the seventh grade level. We don't dictate that from the State Department of Education. We know that we've got to do a better job as students. We all know that. At the Department of Education, we've put a program in place to recognize, with certification as a STEM school, our schools that are doing all the things they need to do in science and math to move the needle forward. When we built out the pathways, recognizing that we've got to connect business and industry and communities to not just K-12 education, but to the world of work, to technical college and the university system of Georgia, we made sure, as we built out over 200 new courses over the past 2 years, that we put steering committees together that were at least 50% plus one representatives from business and industry to make sure we're getting it right. Representatives from places like Delta, or how about UPS or FedEx for logistics? We took their input as we build out the standards that we're having in place to make sure that we are going to be a STEM-ready system for education. We're moving in that direction. We've got the right things in place, and I'm going to stop now because she's very polite with that list. I'd like to put you something on this one.
Okay. Next question. The GMAP, which is the Georgia Measures of Academic Progress, that's replacing the CRCT, but it's no longer a multiple choice test. They can be graded by a computer. Instead, humans have to grade these tests. According to teachers who have seen examples of these test questions, there are several ways a test question can be answered. How can a student results and teacher evaluations be based
on such a subjective grading system. We start with Richard on that one.
You know, one of the things you look at testing, you know, something I was very involved with at the local level. I can tell you, whether it's CRCT, whether it's GMAT, you know, it's still an autopsy report, okay? It does not allow teachers to sit there and make a diagnostic test. It does not say, this is where the student started, this is where they end. To be honest, we test too much in our state. You know, the best qualified person to address the testing needs and meet the needs of the child is the teacher. You know, that's the way it was when I was growing up. When I was growing up, one of the things in the state of Georgia, we basically took one test. That was the IELTS. But that gave the teacher the time to create the test, sit down with the child, and evaluate that. You know, when you go out into life, in the real life of work, you don't send these, you know, applications of this nature. It's very subjective. And so what one person says versus another person, you know, is up to, you know, kind of their total opinion. And so you ask, so I ask you, is that fair to our students? Is it fair to our teachers that their evaluation is based, or, you know, or their performance will be largely based on, quote, the test? You know, and this is incorrect, it's wrong. You know, what we are doing is that, you know, for me as an individual, I believe we should evaluate to educate. We are not doing that. Again, as I said, this is just another autopsy report. You look at the end of the year, push it off to the side, it collects dust. Thank you.
Mike? You know, I look at assessment much like I did to student discipline when I was a high school principal. It needed to be firm, high standards. It needed to be fair, and it needed to be consistent. Those are the same things we're looking about at in any accountability system. We want it to be high, rigorous standards. We want it to be fair to all involved, our teachers, our administrators, our superintendents, our communities, and we want it to be consistent. Yes, the format has changed. It has been changed in order to increase the rigor, to make sure that our students are prepared for those assessments at the end of the road that most parents want their kids to take to get into the schools, the SAT and ACT. Those are aligned to the standards. These assessments are more consistent with what our young people will have to take at the end of the day. We need for them to get the experience and the training in the classroom to perform well. We want our young people to be on a level playing field across this country, but not just against across the country, across the world. So you've got to go into great depth to make sure you've got a fair, consistent process to evaluate how our boys and girls are doing. There's a real rigorous process, and I can really put you to sleep with the technical advisory committees that we have to use to examine each test item and the testing protocol. We have to vet those very thoroughly, and we use people from the field to help us develop the items, vet the items, and make sure they are, in fact, fair.
Let me back up a little bit on that same question then. Do you both agree that it's subjective, the grading system on these tests?
Oh, with open-ended, yes, sir.
Open-ended, yes.
I mean, that's the only way you can evaluate it. Now, you may have a rubric, but it's still, you know, human graded and human subjective to it.
You agree, Mike?
There's what's called inter-rater reliability. And again, that's a concept where we make sure we train and we check to make sure that the ratings that are given by the teachers, by the evaluators, are consistent. But I'm not naive enough to believe that there is no subjectivity in that. We do our level best to eliminate that, but subjectivity does, in fact, enter into some of that despite our best efforts.
Next question. Mike, you'll start this one. According to data on the State Department of Education website, the latest school year for which assessment results of the CRCT are posted is 2010-2011. In that data, it shows 15,385 fourth graders who failed the reading test. First, do you agree that a reading deficiency is a major contributing factor to a child dropping out of school? And secondly, do you think we should be placing more emphasis on mastering reading skills in the lower grades and less time on writing skills and social studies? And we'll start with Mike.
Reading is absolutely the critical skill that all of our young people have to have. We've got to teach them to read so that they can read to learn. So yes, we've got to emphasize that very early on. There are lots of programs out there that can help us do a better job. We've got to get our young people up to grade level reading no later than the end of third grade. And that's why we have built in those reading levels into our CCRPI, where we are now looking at whether boys and girls are on the appropriate grade level, not just at the end of third grade, but through their elementary, middle, and high school years, because there's always been a push around third grade. But just getting our young people to the right reading level does not ensure that you keep them on the right reading level. So we have to intervene early. There was a research study out there that talks about how many millions of words our underprivileged children come to school with. It's like a 30 million word deficit in their early learning years before they ever get to to the elementary schools. We've got to make up that gap. There are programs we can put in place to level the playing field with those young people, and I believe in reading across the curriculum. Most of the boys and girls we lose at the high school level, we don't lose due to a lack of aptitude. We lose them because they're bored out of their gourds. We've got to tie it all together. Yes, reading is vitally important. Yes, we've got to tie it together to make sure that our young people have that skill for all the content areas. Thank you.
Again, literacy is something I've been a strong champion of. It's one of the things that I know growing up in a military family. When I had to travel from East Coast to West Coast, you know, one of the things my mother did is she made sure that I had books in my house. And I shared with a group last night, I still have my, you know, entire collection of Dr. Seuss books that she, you know, raised me up with. And so it is important, because when people do move around or even just have the basics of that, you know, you have that foundation, because that foundation opens opportunity, not just in its reading itself, but in math and science, social studies, you know, in business. Again, business, you know, wants to have individuals who can read, you know, read the manuals that they expect to be operational. And so, yes, we must make the commitment, you know, at that young age, especially in that K-3 area. That's where we really have to do the focus with. But we have to have the flexibility to, you know, allow or give our teachers the flexibility to take the kids where they're at. When you look at standards, we should not be worried so much on grade, but, you know, are their kids obtaining the level of competency they need? Because what we find out is that in some kids where I live, you know, we have a large population, you know, of Hispanic that, you know, they have no English whatsoever. They have no skills. And to say that they have to follow the same standards that we expect everyone to function at and be tested at is unrealistic. You know, our priority should be getting those children up, you know, to reading appropriately. And one of the things we can do, as we talked about, like social studies was mentioned, you know, when we have reading, guess what we read about? We read about American history. We incorporate that across the board. That way nobody is missing out. And also what we need to do is we need to make sure, and one of the things I've looked at is to reach out to our families prior to getting into education. I've looked at, you know, partnering with Dr. Ben Carlson. Some of you may know, he has a reading foundation. We have something called the FIRST Foundation, which is, you know, very active in Georgia. And they are working to put books in the hands of parents prior to our kids getting in there, using our public libraries to do what we used to do well in making sure that our kids are exposed to reading. Thank you.
Richard, you'd be the first one on this one. Over the past several years, teachers, administrators, and parents have said that we test our students too much. It's been said that GMAT has been given more than once a year and on computers, so students will be tested while other students have classroom instruction in the same room. Due to how many computers are available in each school, it would take weeks to administer these tests. I think 3 weeks is the amount of time, if I'm not mistaken, for being allotted. GMAT is not the only testing administered at the grade levels each year. What is the benefit to our students to test them so much?
Well, if you want your kids to fill out A, B, C, D, or take tests, then that's the only benefit that we really have. You know, because if you look at what is the information that we can gather that will say that our kids are where they are, and what can our teachers do to improve it. You know, you look at testing, and again, I came out of the CRCT, and again with the GMAPs, you're looking at the primary that is given towards the end of the year. And depending when your school system would administer that particular test, and again, I'm going back to the CRCT, we're using the same type of format, typically a school system would lose anywhere from four to 6 weeks of instructional time, depending when they give that test. So that's something you have to look at. Remember, our standards are designed to be taught the full 180 days. So when we give that test, it could potentially mean that we're actually cutting into that. Also, remember, we're talking about the test. Teachers know that this test will have, you know, one-to-one correlation on their evaluation. So guess what? They're going to be focused on teaching the test and test prep. So how many days, how many weeks will we, again, put on the front side of that, and we will allocate to test prep instead of instructional time? So those are things we have to really, really look at as far as the testing itself. Again, I submit to you that we test way too much, as I previously said. Now, we need to look at making sure that, yes, we perhaps have some benchmarks, but we have tests that are already there. We can use the date, we could use the hour. Those are benchmarks. Those are things that we do not have to create. I can tell you that the new stuff that's rolling out, they are not benchmarked. We have no idea what's going to happen. Even the DOE, when they came out, they said we could see lower test scores next year when we start rolling out. I will tell you this, you will see low test scores next year when they roll out. It takes several years, you know, for testing to get, you know, up to where we are. So, you know, we're, again, treading unknown water with this, but it is going down the same path that we've seen on, you know, with the CRCD.
If I was king for a day and I could change some of the model of assessment, I would like to see gateway year testing. I would like to see more formative assessment to guide instructional practice than I would what we're doing currently. But the game we're in, our public expects accountability measures. We need accountability measures to ensure that what we're doing is working. As far as testing window, I'm a fan of as broad a flexibility as we can possibly offer the local district. You've got to set up a time frame that allows them the flexibility to do what they want to do. That testing window is different for Savannah, Chatham area, where I was recently, and tourism is huge. It's different for North Georgia. So we need to provide as much flexibility as we can for the assessments to occur, allow us to get the results back in, and then for the districts to be able to make those decisions on whether the young people move forward or not, what kind of remediation we need to provide. All of this should be designed to enhance student achievement, and that gets lost in the shuffle. But if you don't have some metrics, some measure, how do you know whether you are doing the right thing? How do you know if it's working? So we've got to do a better job of that. I have a great fear of penalizing our kids who haven't had the opportunity to gain the expertise on keyboard. I don't want the test to be assessments of keyboarding skills. I want them to be assessments based on content and knowledge. So we've got to do a better job of providing the infrastructure our districts need to do this assessment in a timely manner.
Mike just brought up something about keyboarding. And you think about this. Most children today are accustomed to touch screen. Phones, iPads, everything touch screens from age 6 months up. But anyway, these tests are administered on the keyboard. That's what we're talking about. When are they taught keyboarding? To be efficient at keyboarding, so they can be efficient on a test.
Again, that's a local decision on what they do with computer labs, computer training with their children. That it varies greatly from state to state. We don't mandate keyboarding instruction at a particular grade level. We leave that decision up to the local district. One, they've got to know if they've got the expertise, the lab space to do it, and when, and also when it's been most effective, and whether they've got the instructor that can do a good job for that. But I do know that we've got to get better at that so that we're not freaking the kids out. The first time they do something online is when they've got an assessment. We've got to prepare them for that process well in advance.
Well, I think with technology, it's a wonderful tool, but it's just a platform. You know, one of the things we look at with Irwin County, I mean, most of our kids, we started keyboarding about third grade, so we had a little bit of, you know, experience with that. But, you know, one of the things we look at, some of the research that's coming out, is the, you know, does reading, you know, on the computer, does that actually lower test scores or your ability there? And so I think that's a concern there. When we look at that, what are we expecting our kids, you know, to do? You know, will it hurt their performance? Also, one of the things, somebody that, I love technology, but technology costs money, okay? You know, the state is expecting all the states, all of our schools to go online, and my question is, who's going to pay for it? You know, technology has to be updated. And, you know, we cannot push the bill down to the local levels. I'm also with testing, again, we're looking at the end of the year. You know, you're looking at almost 180 days, and you're saying, okay, let's see what our child has learned. You know, for me as an individual, a teacher, I want to make sure that I'm testing regularly on the front side so that I can make the corrections, you know, early on. Because if I wait to the end of the year to find out what my child learned or didn't learn, you know, I basically lost a full year. So we need to make sure that when we look at testing, while we're testing, make sure it does benefit. Make sure that it is sensible, and not only for the kids, but we need to make sure our teachers are trained with it. So many times as an educator, I've seen technology pop up in my classroom, but I never received any training. And so that's another part of the process that we have to make sure that people who are in charge of the testing actually know what they're doing as well.
Mike, you'll be first on this. The state funding for all school districts in Georgia is based on what is called a QPE formula. And it's considered by many to be totally outdated. How can you tell us in layman's terms what QPE formula is, and how you would advocate for it to be changed?
Yes, the QPE formula is a setup where you are receiving funds in the local district based on the type of students you get and by segments in the day where they are being served. A special needs student, you will draw more funds for each segment that student is being served in special ed, recognizing that you're going to have smaller class sizes for that group. It's basically upon a traditional 25 student classroom in a general time span area. The formula itself was a piece of art when it was devised, but it has not been updated in quite some time. We don't give $1 for instructional resources, for textbooks, that type of thing. It doesn't pay nearly enough for what you have to pay substitute teachers. So that part is dated and needs to be updated, but the reality of the situation is we've got to determine how much money we've got to fund education and work from that number. We don't need another study committee to come up with what we need to do, but then it requires more money and we don't do it. We need to have a fair assessment of the money available, and let's work backwards from that to find a fair, equitable method to distribute those funds. I'm a big fan of flexibility. I think those districts that are hitting it out of the park, we ought to give almost total flexibility with the dollars we give them. The districts that are not doing as well, we need to take a little bit of that autonomy away and work with them to make sure that we're providing and meeting the needs of our students. So we've got to do those kinds of things. We got to quit looking at education as an expense. We've got to start looking at it as an investment, because a good educational system is the driver for economic growth and development in any state.
With QPE, again, the form of funding, it was actually established in 1985. So I guess it was maybe a plan on it. The Democrats were in control back then, so we got what we got, you know, based on that. But miraculously, since 1985, it's never been fully funded. You know, that's one of the things we look at, and that, you know, we have to make sure that we are adequately funding education, because it is a constitutional responsibility. But also that means that for me as an individual, work with funding, work with determining class size, which came down from QPE. I can tell you that many of our school systems, when they looked at the QPE formula, they were trying to maximize the number, you know, the amount of money that they received. You know, they did not look at it wasn't the benefit of the child. And I can tell you that some things that we were doing, especially with high needs kids, you know, we were grouping kids in larger class sizes than they actually needed to be. Big group, because it was determined by that formula. You know, so it was like, what is, you know, how much money can we possibly get, you know, but not taking into account, is it the best thing that we can do for our kids? And so that's where we need to look at our funding formula. Now, one of the things I've always been a strong proponent of, you know, is something more of a block grant type, you know, initiative. And that way that we give the local, you know, you at the local level, the money, and let you devise, you know, take that pool and build the educational system that best meets the needs of your kids. you know, don't be so restrictive with that. One of the things we've looked at, you know, with education is that there's a lot of restriction on funding and how we can spend. We need to have flexibility with that so that we can meet those needs across the board. And I think, you know, part of that process, you know, begins by doing a complete audit of the Department of Education, looking how we can save money, looking at, are we over-regulated so that we can free up some of that money so that you can be more efficient and meet the needs of your kids at the lower level. Thank you.
This is just a quick answer from both of you. Do either one of you know how many people are directly employed in the Department of Education, Georgia Department of Education, and how many were directly employed under Secretary Kathy Cobb? Do either one of you know?
I don't know how many were employed under Kathy Cobb. That was before my time. Right now, that number is around 900 employees, but over 300 of those are our state schools.
And again, the figures that I have previously heard, you know, ranged around the number of 800. And again, part of that is how many people are actually dealing with or looking to have a job that administers federal programs. So, you know, some of that will maybe cross over with the federal government and their responsibility.
We're going to have a series of questions where we have 1 minute. Two, what steps would you take to reduce bureaucratic layers and costs within the DOE? And we start with,
Again, as I've looked at that, I think we do need to have a full audit of the Department of Education. And that means from a regulatory standpoint, it means personnel as well, so that we can look at, you know, peeling back the onion and see, you know, where our cost overruns, what are some things that we can look at. I think looking how we attack the budget itself, doing some business practices with that to see, hey, can we make those adjustments across the board and save or reduce personnel that's not necessary. You know, those are the things that what we can control, and doing a complete audit across the board, you know, is what we need to focus on. But I would encourage local school boards to do that as well, because what you have found out with government, that it tends to grow, it never shrinks. And so that's why that each year we need to start with a zero-based budgeting, assault, and we'll attack on that, but also annually review our personnel to make sure we stay current and not let the system just grow out of control. Right?
This is not something I have to think about and come up with a plan. I'm involved with that process every year when we put up our strategic plan and talk about how we're going to allocate resources. But there's a fallacy out there, and you need to hear me loud and clear. We are not a top-heavy administrative-laden organization. When I got there, 3.5 years ago, I believed some of that because I was at the district level. I knew we had math issues, I was going to fix it. I got to the DOE, I got a new job and a new title. I'm going to find my math department. I'm going to fix these issues. You know what my math department was? One person, and she is awesome, just like the rest of our program specialists. But I had one. Most districts have an academic coach in math, in just math, at each high school, plus all of the math teachers. I had one in the department to be the expert, K-12. That is ludicrous to think that person can do everything that needs to be done. That's just one content area. We took a 25% cut in our central office budget this past year. I had to send good people home because we didn't have the funding to do what we need to do for Mosey girls.
All right, just yes or no. Did you vote for the charter school amendment that passed overwhelmingly in 2010?
No, I did not.
Mike, the charter school amendment of 2010.
No. The right of parents to choose the best school for their child is a part of the Republican platform and has been supported by every GOP presidential candidate from Ronald Reagan to Mitt Romney. So, do you support the right of a parent to choose the best school for their child? And we'll start with Mike.
Well, I've got three school-aged children. I've got 10 girls that will be going into fifth grade at West End Elementary and Long City School. Little man turns 8 this week. He's going into the second grade. I absolutely believe that my right as a parent and every other parent's right to make a decision about you as the best for their child. I will fight to the death for parents to have that right. Now, as your state school superintendent, it is my job to make sure that public school is the choice for parents. But I certainly respect the right for them to make that choice, and I will do everything in my power to make sure public ed is the choice for parents across this great state. And by the way, it is for about 92% of our people.
Again, being a strong person who is, you know, really loves homeschool and private school. We need to make sure that we protect that right. Now, as your next state school superintendent, one of the things, and again, it's in 2010 when I ran, my commitment was to make sure that the government did not interfere or infringe on the autonomy of these two groups. They have to have that right of independence, and so we need to make sure that those parents that choose that route, that they have the complete autonomy they need to make sure that they make the right choice for their kids. Now, one of the things we look at with Common Core, especially with the College Board, that private school and homeschool people saying, Richard, I'm afraid, because now it looks like I may have to make a choice that I may have to adopt something I don't want to adopt. And so we need to make sure that we fight for the right of our parents to be autonomous, and make sure that we do not be involved with data collecting across the board as well. And make sure that the only data that is exchanged between a school is between a school and a parent. So let's keep our rights protected and keep them local.
Going back to the charter school amendment that you both said that you did not vote for it, in 60 seconds, would you tell us why you did not vote for it? Mike?
Richard? Again, for myself, it was more of a constitutional concern that I had with that, because as I look at this, that it created another appointed board instead of an elected board. And that was something that we already had, an appointed state school board to do that. We look at expanding government, and creating things that, that took away local control in our, Constitution. And again, the route that the state Supreme Court fell, that was what I, believed in. And so my issues were not so much against charter schools, which I love charter school and I love charter school concept. And, I think that local communities need to have the right to make those choices for their kids. But also as a constitutionalist, that's the first thing I look at. With any administration, with any policy or anything that's being proposed, my eyes look at the U.S. and the Georgia's Constitution. Because, as I said, if we don't get that right, we don't get anything right. So that was my concern, and that's where I stood, not against the charter schools concept.
Yeah, and I'm going to be fairly consistent with that. I don't have a thing more against charters. If there was a charter in my area that served the needs of my kids, that's where they'd be going to school. But I'm not a big fan of creating another bureaucracy to do what two other entities can already do. And I certainly am not in favor of spending another $1.5 million, $2 million, whatever it might be, the final price tag on that, when we haven't fully funded education. We haven't fully funded public education in quite some time, and two-thirds of our districts operated at less than 180 days in the past calendar year. Until we fully fund what we got, I don't see the need to create another entity and spend dollars that rightfully belong in the local school districts educating our children.
How do you feel about zero tolerance in our schools, and how do you plan to work with the legislature to allow common sense to prevail again in our schools? Mike?
Zero tolerance on anything is a dangerous, slippery slope. Every circumstance is a little different. I am all for safe schools. I want safety in every school. But you've got to have some administrative discretion and some common sense in how you deal with different issues, different children. You've got to be way in past performance. You've got to weigh into intent. There's a big difference between the first grader with a Tweety Bird, little bitty tiny pin like this you got at Disney World, and a 12th grader who's mad at another teacher or student who brings in a butcher knife. Those are two different cases. A zero tolerance would have you doing the same thing for both of those kids. I think we can all agree that's a bad road to travel.
Well, again, as an individual who's personally had to deal with this, zero tolerance, something that, we need to just kind of throw out. Let the adults do it on a one-to-one basis, because each situation is different. There are times when we look at with our kids, and again, even down in Irwin County, we had a kid who knew that he had his knife, had accidentally put it in his pocket, but brought it to the administration, and they reported the child. They followed, quote, zero tolerance. Now you tell me, the kid who was doing the right thing, did not want to get in trouble, gets in trouble. And that's not common sense, and that's not right. Because there are times that we as administrators need to sit back and look at, and we need to evaluate our laws. And that's part of that audit process that we need to look at and make sure we put the right things, do the smart things. Because education is not hard. A lot of times we make it hard. I'll just kind of close, you know, when I was growing up and starting my life, you know, we had kids bringing deer rifles to school and we never saw anything about it. So, you know, you can take that for what it's worth.
Okay. Just for everybody to know, we're getting close to that 1 hour mark. I have two more quick questions for 1 minute answers each, and then we'll go to a 2 minute closing statement. For next question, do you believe that schools should be gun-free zones, and do you believe that we should advertise with a sign out front that we don't have any guns in here to protect ourselves? Mike?
No, Richard should go first. Come on now. No, I'll take it. I tell you, I've lived it. I was a high school assistant principal for 7 years. I was a high school principal for 7 years. And I don't want a whole lot of firepower in the building, right? I want to change the culture of our building. There are a lot of things you can do to change the culture. I could go into great detail on how to change the culture of the building. But I'm a strong proponent of school resource officers. I think we need them in each of our high schools. I'd like to see them reach down to the middle schools again. That becomes a funding issue. But I'm a fan of school resource officers for a variety of reasons. They build relationships with the kids. Almost any bad thing that's happened in one of those schools out there, somebody knew about it. If you've got the right SRO, they develop a relationship with kids, they find out about it in advance. SROs can get first responder training, so if a kid falls, breaks a leg, they know what to do in an emergency situation. The click of a button on their collar, they've got 911 coming in. I don't want to shoot out at the OK Corral at the school. And I think the situations that I've seen, that I've been personally dealing with, we can do it another way.
And just quickly, do you believe we should advertise the fact that it's a gun-free zone?
No, I don't want to put a big sticker on there and the bad guys come in.
Again, with this issue itself, I think first you have to look at being on the front end. That means preventative. You know, you need to make sure the schools are designed to be as safe as possible and to limit, you know, access, you know, on the front end. And again, one of the things I face in Irwin County, we have a lot of old schools. And so they were designed, you know, to be very open and easy access. So we need to look at, you know, that on the front end. Now, I think as far as looking at, you know, guns and gun-free zones and with you, you know, you need to decide that on a local level. You know what you're comfortable with. Again, as I said, I'm not here to tell you how to run your school systems, but I'm here to help you with it. Now, for myself as a personal individual, as an administrator, you know, and people have asked me, Richard, would you have carried a gun? I said, absolutely. If it meant protecting my staff, if it meant protecting my students, you bet. I would have done everything that I could have to make sure they were protected. But also, being somebody that's been raised around guns, you have to make sure you have a high degree of training with that. It's not something you can just take for life. Like Marty Five had a gun, okay? That did not make me feel safe. So you need to make sure that you have that training that goes with it.
Barney only had one bullet.
Yeah. But he had one bullet.
Okay, final question, and then we'll move on to the closing statements. Do you believe in education money following the child? And if so, how would you increase the opportunities of education money to follow that child?
I think, you know, typically what you look at in education, within public education, you know, for the most part, the money does actually follow the child. You know, we have two accounts, what we call the FTD, and that allows us to look at our school numbers and things across the board, because it does allow us to actually project the personnel needs that we will need. So there is, you know, you have to have some accountability with being business on the front end so that you know what your needs are, and, you know, so that you can go throughout a calendar year with the appropriate personnel with that. Now, if you're looking at expanding that, you know, or you're talking about whether it would be vouchers, whether it be some type of, you know, homeschool, private school, then I think you need to look at some things, you know, across the board as far as, you know, does that money come with strings attached? As I said, our homeschool, private school, they need to be autonomous. And if this money is coming from any government entity, there is the possibility that it may come with government strings. So you have to be very, you know, mindful of that. We have to make sure that we can fiscally, you know, afford anything that's around the board, and also that make sure we do actually fund our public school systems as well. Thank you.
Yeah, essentially our system does allow the money to follow the child. That's how that whole formula is designed, not only where that child goes, but what segment he's being served in within public education. So I'm a fan of that, and the structure works well. Many of our districts actually have pretty flexible guidelines for people going from one district to another and how we do that. I'm not, however, in favor of money following the child to a for-profit entity out there that has no accountability, no guidelines, and they don't have to say, play by the same rules as our public schools do. So that's where I would draw the line, but in general, for money following the child, I'm a fan.
Mike, would you give us your closing statement?
Absolutely. You know, I'm a parent, and not too long ago, they were going to enter public education for the very first time. I became the rah-rah speaker for our district because I was expected to kind of get everybody fired up and start a new school year. Well, that year, it really hit me. I had trouble sleeping because I was turning my kids, my babies, over to public education. And I discovered there were three things that I wanted. And I'm not much different from any other parent. I want my children to be safe every day. When I drop them off at West End Elementary, I'm going to pick them up at the end of the day in at least as good a condition as I dropped them off. I want to know when I drop my child off, she's going to get a first-class education. And the third thing I want to know is the adults that I entrust my children with are going to love them and treat them as they would their own children. If we get those three things in every classroom and every school, great things will happen, whatever the curriculum might be. I want to be a champion for our kids. My heart is in it. I love educated folks. You know, I believe in results over rhetoric. Mr. Wood's a great speaker. I think I'm pretty decent. But this isn't the way to make the decision. You need to check out past performance. The single best predictor of future success is past performance. A lot of people can talk about what they will do, what they think they can do when they get there. I can talk about what I've done. I've got the experience. I'm the only candidate in the race that can hit the door day one. Imagine how easy it would be for me, the transition planning. I will use the lessons I've learned, and I've learned a lot in 3.5 years. I was naive when I got to the Department of Education about how important those bridges were between superintendent, board, legislature, and government. I've learned those lessons. I can hit the ground running day one.
Thank you. Richard?
Again, I thank each of you for coming out today and spending the time to become informed. And again, I encourage you to continue the process. But as your next state school superintendent, you know, there are certain realities that we have to live with. You know, and again, I try to address that with my platform. First of all, we have to be focused on the kids. You know, at the end of the day, if we fail them, we have failed education in general. And so we need to look at whatever decision we make, you know, is it having a positive or a negative impact on education? And so that's my commitment, you know, as a former classroom teacher and as an administrator, that I will do that and do that with vigor and make sure that we do have that. And that means, you know, expanding their opportunities of choice, you know, giving them, you know, various diploma selection choice, so whether it's technical, vocational, STEM or whatever, or general diploma, that they have that. They receive a good rounded education that gives them opportunity. Because as I've shared, you know, with other groups, I want the Georgia diploma to mean something. Not just something you hang on a wall, but it gives them opportunity to continue their education. It'll give them opportunity to be individuals who are, you know, have gainful employment, one day become business leaders and owners across the board, but also to live successfully within our country as well. You know, that we do things that we force, you know, providing them that foundation. Again, I told you about reading, writing, and arithmetic. That's, you know, something that will be critical. But also teaching them about the greatness of our country. We have to make sure that they understand the exceptionalism of America. You know, that we look at our history, we look at our Constitution, we look at the Founding Fathers, and make sure that is there. Make sure that information also, you know, gives them a strong personal finance, you know, awareness, so they can succeed in the marketplace and know how to balance the budget. It is something I am passionate about, but in all reality, I cannot do this by myself. You know, I need your help, and that's why I am here, because, you know, once I take office, I will not be somebody you see once every 4 years. We have to communicate, because as an elected official, I represent you and each and every individual of Georgia. And that's my commitment, to make sure that we provide our kids the very best education possible so that we lead the nation. Georgia will be number one. As I said before, number six doesn't count. Number one is what our goal is. Thank you.
Let's get both of you. want to thank you all for doing this morning.
I want to thank all of you who sent me questions. There were a lot of questions. If I could just keep your attention just for another 30 seconds, that's all I ask. I want to thank all of you who gave me questions. Many of them were we could not get to this morning. Can y'all both stay around for a while? Okay, just stay around for a while. If you had a question that was not asked, come up here and ask them, okay?